Let me tell you about one of the most heated debates in the United States. It's a polarizing issue, full of bureaucracy, conspiracies, and death threats. You can probably guess what I'm talking about. It's wild horses. Why is that controversial? Apparently, we have too many of them. They're protected under this act passed in 1971 as American mascots, symbols of a rugged pioneer past. The Bureau of Land Management, or BLM, not to be confused with the organization and movement of Black Lives Matter, has made it clear we have completely surpassed our carrying capacity in the Western United States for wild horses and burros. Burros, or burros in Spanish, is donkeys. This limit is a very specific number of 26,715. That has been determined to be the max we can have on the range before the land degrades and so does the health of the horses and burros. In 2021, we are rapidly approaching a number of 100,000. To try to mitigate this number, our tax dollars go to first gathering these animals off their homelands with methods such as helicopter roundups. If the horses and burros are not adopted or sold, then our tax dollars go to feeding them in pastures for the rest of their lives. There are already 50,000 in holding facilities. The wild horse and burro program is at its breaking point. People have a lot of opinions about that. On one side of the spectrum, you have people who say these horses and burros are nuisance animals. They gobble and drink up all the natural resources from native wildlife and livestock lands. The government via the BLM is not doing enough. On the other side of the spectrum, you have people who say these animals have every right to live on the range without any government interference. They want the gathers to stop. They want the horses and burros to live free. No matter where one may fall on the spectrum, everybody has one thing in common. They think the Bureau of Land Management is, well, not managing properly. That's what drew me to this conundrum, was the people. People whose lives revolve around wild horses and burros. Because here in this little bubble is a microcosm of the American condition, the human condition, where there's a huge divide between one extreme and another. As any good millennial would, I made a podcast about it called Wildish, which was published by High Country News. For over a year, I traveled the Western United States, from Oregon to New Mexico, Montana to Nevada. I'd spoke with dozens of people, people like Tammy, a wildlife biologist based in Pennsylvania, who frequently comes out west in the interest of wild horses. Tammy considers herself a true horse person, and the way she talks about her horse, Harry, would make you think Harry is a person. Tammy has loved wild horses since she was little. She even wrote a poem when she was 12 years old in the perspective of a wild horse, and the poem won a contest. Today, she sees more through a lens of her wildlife biologist background. These horses aren't really wild, they're feral, she says. We need stronger management solutions in the interest of native wildlife. On the other side of the spectrum, I talk to people like Otelia, a wild horse photographer living in Rock Springs, Wyoming. Shortly after moving to the United States, Otelia found the wild horses near her home. She fell in love with them too. There's a spirit to them, she says, and she moved me to tears with her plea to stop gathering them the way we do. Some get hurt, some die. It's terrifying for them. There has to be a more humane solution if we have to manage them. Otelia has such a big heart for these horses. She sees each individual horse as just as important as the whole herd. What's strange is of the 26 people I interviewed, Tammy and Otelia were the two that made me laugh the most, that I developed deeper connections with, and they're on opposite sides of that spectrum. When I talk about the podcast, people ask me for the final verdict. Who's right, the pro-horse people or the anti-horse people? And the answer is, I don't know. Both sides make such a compelling case, but I wasn't looking for an answer. This podcast series about horses taught me a lot more about people, how we dehumanize the other side, and how we can start to rehumanize each other. This wasn't an unknown concept to me. My own life experience prepared me for it. I was born and raised in Alabama, and I promise you, I do have an accent. I primarily lived with my single mom. My mom was also a teacher at my school. Therefore, I was always with my mom. My mom was my best friend. I told her everything. She was my security. Her love was boundless and unconditional. When I was 12, we moved a little further north to the country when she got remarried, and we started regularly going to church as a family. I was saved. I was baptized. It was also around that time I started to regularly admit to myself that I liked girls, like I liked boys. I liked girls a lot more than I liked boys. I liked girls a lot. 2005 in the South was a very different world than the world we live in today. Because of all my shame about liking girls and being whatever I was, I began to self-harm. My mom found out. She wanted to know why. I came out to my mom at 12 years old. She said, "Anna, if that's the lifestyle you want to live, then I just want you to be happy." There are so many stories of kids coming out to their parents being met with abuse, neglect, manipulation. In comparison, what my mom told me when I came out sounds fantastic. In reality, it was the last time I felt true acceptance from her. For the next several years, the subject was tense and it was confusing. Like one night, I was eating supper and my mom slid a book beside me. It was a book about how to pray the gay away, how people who followed this lifestyle choice were not truly happy and needed to resist their feelings. I remember not being able to breathe flipping through the pages, but the book wasn't a huge shock because once she had asked me, "Anna, don't you think being gay is like being addicted to drugs? You want what you shouldn't have." And there we were, at opposite ends of a divide. After earning my bachelor's degree, I moved away, all the way to Washington State to become a park ranger. Suddenly, I was surrounded with people who didn't think being queer was weird, which to me was really weird. I had 2,000 miles of space to get angry. And I got angry. I got angry at my Southern roots. I got angry at my Christian roots. Most of all, I got angry at my mother because all I wanted was acceptance, finally. And instead she told me, "Anna, I still pray every day you stop liking girls." Shortly, she apologized for saying that, but something snapped. I started seeing her as just a stereotype, as two-dimensional. All I could see were her beliefs. I would rehearse hard-hitting comebacks and passionate speeches, even thousands of miles away from her, when I'd see her in person again. But when I did see her in person again, when she'd visit me or I'd visit her, we'd simply have these conversations. The rage would dissolve. There was this tenderness. We'd have important ones about climate change, social justice, the state of the world. Until every now and then, we ended up on the subject of me being queer. I realized that across from me was a complicated person. Maybe all those years she was trying to be a good mom, a good Christian mom, the best way she knew how. Maybe she was conflicted. Maybe she was scared. Maybe she made huge mistakes that hurt me, but she still made me who I am. Most importantly, she never made me leave, and she never left. We started mutually moving toward each other after 15 years of unacceptance. I wanted to test the waters a little further though. Shortly before this pandemic roared into our lives, I sent my mom a link to a PFLAG meeting near where she lives in Alabama. PFLAG is an old organization. They used to stand for Parents of Lesbians and Gays. Now it's just PFLAG to be more inclusive for the entire LGBTQIA+ community. After an eternity, which was only a couple days, my mom finally sent me something back saying not only that she had looked into it, but that she was going. And she went regularly before shutdown. I suppose finding solace in a new community of people who understood. My mom and I are still polar opposites on some issues, but I refuse to paint her with such broad strokes, to dehumanize her again. I was justifiably angry, but rage keeps us from hearing each other. We were on our way to losing our relationship. What saved it were those conversations, those hard conversations. And I intend to continue to have those hard conversations with her and everyone else in my life for the rest of my life. Which leads us here to a conversation about wild horses. Yet another American debate where both sides are screaming into the void, enraged at each other's stereotypes, jumping to conclusions, dehumanizing each other. If it weren't for what I learned being queer and from navigating my often futile relationship with my mom, I wouldn't have made this podcast. Or if I did, it would have been about the rage, the extremes, the fringes of that spectrum, instead of seeking out the people who truly knew a thing or two, the complicated, nuanced humans. This isn't just true for wild horses. What we learn from solving this lesser-known problem could serve as a model, helping us untangle a plethora of other polarized headaches we have in the United States and in the world. By opening up and mutually moving toward each other, we can see the people beyond the divide. We can step out from behind any stereotype and start new conversations. Maybe then we can repair the relationships we've lost and move together toward a better world. Thank you.